Print on demand. In the olden days, when old was spelled with an E at the end, in the olden days, you guys get that? Okay. In the olden days, when poets got a contract to do a book, the company actually printed the number of books that was on the contract. So they would say, okay, you know, this contract is for the first 1,000 books. So they would go out and print them, and really made 1,000 hardcover books or whatever. And that also made it difficult to get published back in the day, because you had to find a publisher who was willing to commit books to you like that and pay for them and all of that. So that's now we print on demand. We can make books, have publishers, and basically we just order the books when we want them. So that's opened up a lot for a lot of poets, especially, I'll say poets, because, you know, novelists are their own thing, and narrative writers. But, you know, poets, it's really hard to get poets published. And now I'm just saying it opens up, you know, Kinko's opened up too, and so people can publish their own poetry. But it's a bigger movement now is what I'm saying, you know? So I'm really proud of my brand new book, Papolitico, and this is, I'll play this for you real quick. This is Papolitico arriving in my home yesterday, the day before yesterday. I don't know how to work this computer, but how do I get this to play? I know it plays.
Do you want me to?
I can do the slides.
Okay.
If you want me to forward the slides, you just let me know.
Yeah. Okay. What happened here?
Security alert.
Yeah, you see, what I want, yeah, I want, that's a film, it's 41 minutes.
Oh, you want me to sway it?
Yeah. Okay. It doesn't say slideshow.
Is there a link?
Mm,
I don't think that there's a link.
Oh, okay.
But there's a play.
I'm sorry. I thought it was played. Anyway, so this is pretty funny. If you go to my Facebook page, you'll see it. So I'm walking through the door with the book in the box. And it's just a drawing, you know, it's like, get the fresh book smell, you know, you open it up and everything. But it's funny because then it ends with me putting the book on my head. You know, I do book selfies. And then you picture yourself in book, you know, selfies. Anyway, I'm going to do a whole bunch of them, my friends' books and all of that. So, let me get started. In this book here, I begin it, you know, most times you get an opportunity to do a dedication. I like to dedicate this book to my mom, my dad. I've done that. But I just want to share the dedication in this book because I think it's particularly special. And it's something I'd like to talk about with you. This collection is dedicated to the belief that the nature of poetry.
Where's the chart where we want that?
The nature of poetry is the universal, empathetic expression of the spirit's suffering a human experience. I should write it down. No, not this poem. The belief that the nature of poetry is the universal, empathetic expression of the spirit's suffering a human experience. That's sign language. That's what I just did. Because, you know, I personally, we all walk around with our own personal beliefs. And the thing is to transmit that belief to the world. And it changes all the time. Everybody has their own personal belief, their own personal reality. And so mine is being a poet in this world. And when I started out, I didn't know what the hell that was or what that meant. It took me a while even to figure out that I was a poet. I didn't claim myself and say, oh yeah, I'm a poet. It actually blew my mind when I came to a realization of myself like that. To say, damn, Papa, you must be a poet. You know, and it wasn't something that you know, like I just said out loud and proud, but something like perplexed, really. It's like I had to come to that conclusion. And once I did, then I could move forward. Like when I first showed my writing to my teacher, my high school teacher, I had a tutor, Mary Meredith Wright, and I told Mary. Mary said, "You know, Papa, you write pretty well, you know." But I thought she'd talk about my handwriting, which then I thought she was crazy. So she says, you know, could you bring me some of your writing? You know, so I went home and I had been writing stuff and, you know, I had a little attaché case full of stuff and I selected some and I brought them to Mary. And Mary looked at them and she says to me, you know what these are? And I go, the things I write. And she said, no. And I said, yes, no, yeah, no, yeah, no. What? She said, these things are poems. So I didn't know that. I didn't relate to them as poems. I didn't call them poems. I call them the things I write. And she said, no, these are poems, Papa. You just need to smooth out the rough edges, which I laugh about because my smoothing out the rough edges makes them rougher. So, but let's get to the example. What I want to do today is, I've said this about the empathetic. My thing is that I believe that we are actually spiritual beings having a human experience. There are people that believe that we are human beings having a spiritual experience. So you see, it goes either way. But I believe that. I believe we are more spirit than matter. And you know, to me, I can't wait to get to the other side. You know, I'm not going to seduce my destiny because I think you have to wait. See, I think there's two, the prime directive of life is gather as much information as you can and live as long as you can to gather that information. Those, to me, those are the prime directives of life. It's a learning experience. So, I want to talk about today your inner voice, your own ability to express yourselves. We're going to do a little experiment with the candles, a little exercise. How many of you were here last year with me?
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. Because I will be redundant. But first I want to show you some important. This is a poem on page 9 in my new book called Indentured. Now, all poems have a history. They come from somewhere. Like we were discussing earlier, poetry versus spoken word. You know, and for a long time, I was anti-spoken word, although, I confess it's okay, I was anti-spoken word poetry, although the New Eureka Poets Movement and the Black Arts Movement spawned spoken word poetry. Now you see it everywhere you go. You go to movies, there's a hip-hop, the movie begins with a hip-hop thing. All of those things are influenced by our movement. The New Eureka Poets Movement and the Black Arts Movement and the Post-Beat Movement. These are all poetic movements. And that's where all of this stuff comes from. I know poets that wouldn't be writing if it weren't what we had done prior. Because they wouldn't have that notion unless they saw it somewhere else. Because there are people like that. They can only be inspired by something they see. They can't be inspired necessarily by something already happening. What I believe. But anyway, poetry, the spoken word, I said, oh, wait a minute. I disagree, you know, and I had a big problem with that. But I've been enlightened. So it's not that I don't like spoken word. I don't like to talk bad about spoken word because I see the light, and I'm going to translate it to you. I consider poetry to be an outside-inside thing. Something happens outside where the poet is standing, observed, is affected by it, and writes about it. That's outside in. Inside out is, I have something to say. See, and spoken word is an inside out technique, which works because the empathetic element of it is yourself. The poet is having self-empathy in the spoken word situation, and because of that, it becomes universal. And it's all connected. So there's nothing to be mad about. There's nothing to be jealous about. It's just different. And that, again, is what the world is about. Differences coming together. So I just want to say that because I think it's an important thing for people to think about. But, our societies are getting more selfie, and more selfish, and less selfless. I'm telling you. So we need to try to hold hands in as many different ways as possible. So, you know, away with division and find unity and empathy in everything that's happening. For here, for instance. The IRS finally caught up with me a few years ago. I haven't paid taxes my whole damn life. In fact, I missed the deadline yesterday.
It was extended.
It was extended, yes. I missed it three times in 1 year. It was yesterday. Yeah. But anyway, so the IRS calls me up and they tell me, well, they don't call me up, they actually go to my house. And they leave a letter under my door. And when I went to the IRS, I said, listen, lady, you're lucky I wasn't there when you went to my house and left that thing under my door, because I do not like anybody coming to my house without my permission. So, you know, I'd have cursed you out if you'd have knocked on my door and told me you were the IRS and here's a letter for you. I'd have told you to put a stamp on it. You know, you know, support your government, put a stamp on it. So finally, they dragged my butt over to the IRS office, you know, to explain my life to them. So, okay, to make a long story short, they had me pay them $150 a month for a couple of months. They had me do like 5 years of taxes and everything. And when they got through with me, they owed me $17,000. Even though I never paid taxes in my life, they owed me $17,000. Yes, poets function at a loss. So I go to the IRS office and I'm really irate. You know, the lady's African-American who's hassling me, and I'm thinking, what about your 40 acres and the mule? How's that working out for you, lady? Yeah, but no, I can't tell her that because I know it's going to happen if I do tell her that. But I'm thinking it. So I come out of the thing, out of the office, and I'm all like, kind of like, woe be gone, and, you know, these damn people and all this hypocrisy and everything. And this happened. So that's why I wrote the poem, and I titled it Indentured. Now, this is my style, which I call cascaded. So we'll get into it, but indentured. Okay, I'm going to read it. You ask questions, okay? In the United States of America, an old black man in 21st century, 125th Street, Harlem, with a broom and dustpans in his hands, cursing while chasing this empty bag of potato chips, twirling round on the sidewalk in this circle. Blame the wind. Any comments, questions?
Is that you? Who is the old black
man? An old black man that I saw. What's it? I come out of the IRS. It's on happens to be on 125th Street in the heart of Harlem. And I'm walking home and I see this. And so then, you know, I stop right there and I write the poem about what is happening. But there's some questions I want you to ask. Yes?
I was just struck by the time. It's such a small moment. Instead of like a poem I would remember from years ago where there'd be a whole story that would go through maybe months, years, or whatever, tell a whole history.
Right.
This is like a tiny little moment.
Yes, and the thing about it is that, see, you see the space there? Now I went through a lot of trouble with those three words. It was like, blaming the wind, blames the wind, blah, 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 until I finally said, no, I don't blame the wind. I mean, the problem with this, you blame the wind. He's doing this because it's a post-slavery movement. Yes?
Why is it just one scene?
Well, see, okay, we walk around with opinions. I didn't want to say in the United States of America. First of all, I have a problem with that because I don't think the states are that united. You know, so personally, I have a problem with it, so I'm not going to say something I have a problem with. So I remove the S. When I remove the S, everybody goes around correcting it. This, I put in the S in there for me, as if I left it out. You know, so I got mad at that. I said, okay, I will put the E capital in parentheses. Mess with that. You know, I mean state, not states, dude. So that's why the E is in capital. And if you look at it, it also stands for E pluribus unum, which is on the dollar bill, right? What is that, all for one, right? Okay, here's the thing. My analysis is that the reason why the old black man has to chase this bag of potato chips is because of slavery and because of the history of black people in this country. And that's why this old black man who should be sitting on his ass smoking a cigar and looking at the clouds instead is chasing this goddamn paper, empty bag of potato chips, because he has to do this to make a living, to make ends meet. And that's stupid. So blame the wind. If you don't want to blame reality. That's what that's about. Okay? Very good. Any other questions? Comments? Okay. So where do poems come from? Like that, walking down the street, even the IRS, seeing the irony of this and go. Irony is my inspiration, okay? That's it. You have to, I hate hypocrisy. To me, hypocrisy is the worst thing in the world. It is actually the mother and father, not to blame it on women, of all evil. Hypocrisy. People are hypocritical. You know, I'm hypocritical. You know, I'm horny, and you're a woman, and I'm a hypocrite, so I'm going to rape you because your life is worth less than my pleasure. You see the hypocrisy in it? Same thing with murder. You know, my life is more important than your life, and you got something I want, so I'm going to kill you. That's hypocrisy. So, that's how I punish it. Okay, here's another poem. I'll walk you through this one. Oh, the Million Youth March. Okay. So, you remember the Million Youth March in Harlem?
Yeah.
Okay. Several years ago with Khalid Muhammad. So, I went down there to listen. I wrote two poems that day. Okay? I wrote two poems that day. It was a terrible day. The police were messing with everybody. It was supposed to be on 125th Street and 7th Avenue. I live in East Harlem on 11th Street. So I go over there, and the police are standing, and they say, no, you can't come in here. You got to go to 127th Street and 8th Avenue, and then you can come in. All of this is all blocked off, so you got to walk. You can't know where you get over there, and they tell you to go back where you just came from. They were doing that all damn day. Okay, finally, I got into the thing, and the first poem I wrote is called The Cop Haiku. A Cop Haiku. And this morning, when I was on my way here, I'm sitting in Penn Station in the train before it takes off, and in comes W.C. Cortez, who's an actor, and he's a real police officer. He's a lieutenant, and he's in uniform, and he comes to the train to say hello to me and ask me where we're going. And I said, oh, I'm coming over here to Suffolk, are you ready? And I showed him my new book, because I know Cortez. He was in, what is it, Gotham? He played the cop in Gotham, but he's a real police officer. So I said, oh, look, I want you to read the first poem in the book, A Cop Haiku. So here we go, A Cop Haiku. I wrote this, it's funny, you know, there's a bit of these parts that you can write an epic poem, you know, like something, you know, Langston Hughes type thing, or Frederick Douglass, you know? Group of cops buying coquitos. Different flavors, different cops. CW laughed and left the train. Got it? Group of cops buying coquitos, different flavors, different cops. Now, there's this big demonstration going on, you know, everybody's angry. Papa's sitting there writing poems about piraguas, you know, little ices. You know, but then I wrote this one later on. I read from my book. Okay. Now you see the structure of this poem doesn't have too much cascadence. I mean, poems usually look like this: flush left, ragged right. Because I do want to talk about spacing in words. You know, like how, you know, in poetry, it's the breaking of the words to give the poem the rhythm. You know, so here, in Million Youth March, the concert ends exactly. The concert ends at exactly 9 o'clock, yet the entitled couples linger in Central Park, way past midnight, mesmerized by the silent eyes of the full moon against the blackened sky. But But the million-year march must end emphatically an hour past 3 in the afternoon. Because this is a society, the majority afraid of the minority, untrusting of its youth, though its future, they love to say, is entirely in its own hands. Although this is a holiday weekend, and there's no school till Tuesday morning, the police state of denial, part and parcel to the dysfunctional denial that mistrusts itself for lack of faith, that instructs one to turn the other cheek while no one better lay a hand on it, the other, while they are being beat in all the Negro streets, not shown on any TV news, not sharing views contrary to the status of the status quo, programmed into thinking its belief is its own innocence. That's the second poem that I wrote at the Millennium March. Then there was another one that I was attempting. It was much longer and got into it. It was all political. Maybe later. But I'm just trying to let you know that, you know, poems come from actual real places. Things that happen, and that's the beginning. For me, it's got to be ironic. Okay, let's. I got one here that I want to do with you. Let's. It's on the other page. The other. Let me see. I don't know. This one. Yeah. This one. Yeah. Okay. I don't know. Yeah. Okay. Now this. We're gonna scroll through this. This is called Anatomy of a Poem. Let me find the poem here first. The name of this poem is. Subway Sleeper. I'm just getting used to my new book. Okay. You know, I just put this together. I don't know anybody uses it, but I know they're here. Okay. Subway. See, so I'm gonna. We could go to pick this girl to the next one. Thing. So let me tell you about this. So I'm here. Okay. Is it okay? Okay. This is actually my note. Wrote the poem. I don't know if that's a 7 or a 9. I think it's 2007. I always put that little thing there to not confuse myself. This piece of paper is actually probably 3 inches by 5 inches. Little notebook.
Yeah. Little notebook like this. I buy these in the 99-cent store and I walk around with them until they buy a bunch of them. This is real cool.
Anyway, so this is page 1. So, like I said, it took me a long time to figure out what inspires me to write. But one day I sat and thought about it, and I figured out it's irony. The minute I encountered the ironic moment. So, let's see if we can find the ironic moment. Okay? Now, these are the notes to the poem. Can you guys read my crazy handwriting? My mother told me that You need a spiritualist to read my handwriting. Sure. This is not my pinita. Okay, so let's scroll up a minute. Okay, so here's the poem. I'll start the beginning for you so you can see it. It says, man on subway train sleeping across 4 seats in the corner on the morning rush hour train to work. His combat construction worker type boots stretched out to the very end of the row of seats, so no one else can sit there. It has a little asterisk. Okay. Oh, welcomed or not. I have a really funny handwriting. Okay, well, it's chicken scratch. Okay, thank you. So, this is the part we're going to focus on. Okay, so it says, it's 9 o'clock in the morning, and he looks like he's been sleeping there for hours, perhaps throughout the entire night. Look at the word throughout. Throughout the entire night. His head is pillowed by a see-through plastic bag. Looks like a garbage bag full of stuff. Okay. Okay. I'm going to read you the whole poem, but we didn't. Okay. So then, his winter parka, which I spell wrong. His winter parka, right? All buttoned up tight to keep him warm, and his left hand in his jeans pocket, perhaps protecting a wallet of loose change, and his left knee just slightly bent, and you see the teeth, slightly bent, okay, for comfort's sake. Okay, to make him more comfortable this morning. Now you see how that, to make him more comfortable, you know I'm not going to keep that. To make him more comfortable, but I'm going to do something to it. On his commute, as the train fills up with more passengers, having awakened, showered, and shitted. Breakfasted or not, because in the army, you know, it's shit, shave, shower. And I took poetic license to put shit at the end. So I wanted to shower, shave, and shit. Breakfasted or not, got up from his bed. Something else happened here. Got dressed and left their humble abodes. Right? Walked out into the blistering cold and are now off to work. Right? And are now off something, I don't know what, and are looking for the train while something or other weighs there. The seat that they paid for, and then sometimes someone's life falls down. In parentheses. Okay, watch. This is that goes to Anatomy of Poem. Because these are just five pages that created the poem I'm about to read to you. But this is what the pages went through. And people hate to rewrite. But you see, when you first write something down, it's just what you have on the surface of your skin. You see? And then when you look deeper in it, it opens up to you like a lotus. It opens up because there's more than you actually know about that. No matter what it is, shoelaces or spaghetti, or ravioli, doesn't matter. You know a whole lot about a whole lot of things, but you don't investigate it. I'm not saying you, I mean, you know, us and we, you know? But if you do, you'll find it. You know a whole lot about it. So this is what's happening. So now, see it says page one? I went home. I wrote that on the subway while the train was moving. I go home, and I got a bigger piece of paper. And now I try to recreate what I wrote in my notebook, kind of neat, you know, so I can make it out. So man on subway train sleeping across four seats in the corner on the morning rush hour train to work. His combat construction worker type boots stretched out to the very end of the row of seats, so as no one else can sit there, welcomed or not. Remember, welcomed is on the old side, right? And then it says, it's 9 o'clock in the morning, and he looks like he's been sleeping there for hours. Perhaps throughout the entire night. Now, it grew. His head is pillowed by a see-through plastic bag, looks like a garbage bag full of stuff, now his life's belonging. His winter parka, still spelled incorrectly, his winter parka all buttoned up tight to keep him warm, and his left hand in his jeans pocket, perhaps protecting a wallet of loose change, and his left knee just slightly bent for his comfort's sake on his commute as the train fills up with more passengers. Right? You know I'm not going to keep that. Having awakened, showered, and shaved, and shitted, breakfasted or not, got up from their beds, got dressed, and left their humble abodes, walked out into the blistering cold, and are now left standing, looking forward, that I had thought, in aisles against the opening and closing of doors. There's a little side there, you see? And I said, it goes somewhere in here. Looking for the seat that they paid for on the morning train to work. And then remember the little guy in the bottom of parentheses? He got a little bit bigger too. Sometimes someone's life just falls right down, and so one needs a nap. Okay, now. Then I type it! And I said, okay, now we're ready here. Type the poem up. And still. Okay, bring our focus back your way, okay? Sometimes someone's life just. See? That little thing where in parentheses decided to become the beginning of the poem. It's the why. So, is this okay? Is this going right, guys? Like, I have no idea. Okay. So, sometimes someone's life just falls right down and someone needs to take a nap in life. Man on subway train, sleeping
And I didn't like sleeping there, so I'm going to move it somewhere. Across 4th Street to the corner of morning rush hour train to work. His combat construction worker type booth stretched out to the very end of the row of seats so as no one else can sit there beside him, spider or human or not. It just occurred to me, spider or human or not. Right? Along came a spider and sat down beside her. Okay, yeah. It's 9 o'clock in the morning, and he's been sleeping there for hours, perhaps throughout the entire night. His head pillowed by a see-through plastic bag, looks like a garbage bag full of stuff, not of dreams, not all that belongs to him. And his winter parka, still spelled it correctly, all buttoned up tight to keep him warm, and his left hand in his jeans pocket, perhaps protecting a wallet of loose change. I call these traffic signals. his left knee just slightly bent for his comfort's sake on his commute, and I go, unlike vermouth. Okay. I don't look for the rhymes until later. Okay, the rhymes are the last thing. Because then I see, well, what rhymes with this? And then I find something else that's hilarious. So, for his comfort's sake on his commute, unlike wine to vermouth, as the train fills up with more passengers passing by on their ways to work, having awakened, showered, changed, and shitted breakfast in a knot, got up from their beds, got dressed, and left their humble abodes, walked out into the blistering cold, and are now left standing frigidly in aisles against opening and closing doors, looking for the private seat that is, whatever, the day. This morning, having slipped their Metro cards, and I go through, thus they paid for, right? The result of this, so desperately, there is no more a seat to sit upon. So you see how the poem is doing its own thing. To me, these are not things that I'm doing, these are things that I'm discovering while I'm playing around with the poem. And then we go back to the typewriter. This is my computer. I keep upgrading them and I throw them away. But I print them. I have all of these. They're in the folder. Every poem that I write has every note that took to write it with it. That's my archive. So when I give it to the college, you can actually see this in every one of my poems. They're there, all of them. Don't throw nothing away. Now we got all of that, and see these things? This is where I want them. This guy's gonna begin right here. See? I start moving them around. Alright. So it's called anatomy of a bone. Okay. His head pillowed by a see-through plastic bag. Looks like a garbage bag full of stuff, not of dreams. Now all that belongs to him. See, it says, I'm still playing on it. And his winter parka, which I just learned how to spell. All buttoned up tight to keep him warm, and his left knee. And his left knee in his jeans pocket, perhaps protecting a wallet of loosely held. You see, change from loose change because I didn't like it. Loosely held change. And his left knee. Just slightly bent for his comfort's sake on his commute, unlike wine to vermouth. As the train fills up with more passengers passing by on their ways to work, having awakened, showered, shaved, and shitted, purpose, did it not, blah, 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 blah. Okay, and here it is. let me go to. Yeah. I want it in the other one, because there it is. But it's right there. Okay. I'm going to read it to you while it happens. Okay? And then any questions after this? Okay. So here it is in its entirety. You keep up with me?
Yes, sir.
So the first part is kind of like a little disclaimer to the poem, but it says here, remember, because this all happened, so now I want to put it together so that it makes sense to a reader.
You know, because it makes sense to me. I went through this process, but now I want to make sure that, so here it is.
Sometimes someone's life just falls right down, and so one needs to take a nap in life. Man on subway train, sleeping across four seats in the corner on the morning rush hour train to work. His combat construction worker-type boots stretched out to the very end of the row of seats so as no one else can sit there beside him, spider or human or not. It's 9 o'clock in the morning, and he looks like he's been sleeping there for hours, perhaps throughout the entire night. His head pillowed by a see-through plastic bag, looks like a garbage bag full of stuff, not of dreams. Now all this left belongs to him. And his winter parka, all buttoned up tight to keep him warm, and his left hand in his jeans pocket, perhaps protecting a wallet of loosely held change, and his left knee just slightly bent for his comfort's sake. On his commute, unlike wine to vermouth, as the train fills up with more passengers passing by on their ways to work, having awakened, showered, shaved, and shitted, breakfasted or not, nevertheless got up from their beds, got dressed and left their humble abodes, walked out into the blistering cold, and are now left standing frigidly in aisles against the closing and opening of doors, looking for the promised seat that they, this morning, having slipped through their metro cards, thus they paid for and had hoped so desperately for, the seat that is no more a seat to sit upon, but for the homeless to sleep. So, we still have time. What do we have time for?
Yeah, we've got about 20 minutes.
Oh, okay. So, okay. Any questions? Any rebuttals? Anything? I just want some feedback for you guys. Any thinking that you want to answer?
You said irony was important. Could you spell out the irony?
The irony in the poem is, well, see, okay. So my encounter is, I hardly ever have to be anywhere for rush hour. I hardly ever have to participate in rush hour. But every now and then I do, and it always freaks me out. Like this morning, you know, I got up at 5 in the morning, and I, you know, just to get here by 11. So I'm like that, a little kid. To me, it's Christmas Eve. But I have something to do. It's like Christmas Eve, you know. So anyway, so I walk in the train one rush hour morning, and I notice the train, you know, the train pulls in, and I notice that everybody's jam-packed over here, and the rest of this car is empty. So, oh, well, you guys are stupid. And I go on the train, and the minute I get it, I figure out why, and they're like real tight on the other side, a line, and they're all here like this, you know? And I don't move. I stay right where I am. It stinks. This person stinks. And they're taking up, just like the poem. So that, to me, is the ironic moment. That's why everybody's over there, because he stinks. Right? So out comes the pen, and I start what I call still life poetry. I start like basically like when you go to art class and they put up, you know, the wine and the oranges in the bowl and everything, and everybody's sitting in their own perspective drawing that. That's basically what I'm doing. You know, I'm just making the raw notes for a still life painting with words. And so, you know, but again, that took me a long time to figure out. It's not like I'm super smart, you know. It's like I just think about this and I go, well, I'm a metaphor guy. Everything is, what is this like? You know, metaphor, simile, what is this like? This is like, well, I used to get in arguments with people when I was a kid. And I go, oh, yeah, oh, you know what that's like? It'd be like that, you know. Get pushed in the nose. But anyway, so that's the irony. You see, and the irony in the cop poem, the cop haiku, is that I'm having all this hassle from all these police, and here they are buying coquitos like little children. And they're all excited about it, too. They're all like, oh, I want a cherry. They got guns and everything. I want an orange. It's so ironic. You know, it's like they're treating everybody like shit, but they want an icy. You know, it's like any other kid on a warm day. God, you know. So then, you know, irony and poems and the like. Okay, I want to share one more poem with you. Let me see if I have it on here. Do we have Osui Societality?
I think it's in there.
The man, okay. Now, okay. This, I'm just going to share this one with you, you guys can read along. This, like I said, things actually happen. I used to live on 5th and Market Street. This is the cover of this book is looking out onto 5th and Market Street in San Diego. And many things would happen in front of my window. So one day, this happens in front of my window. Now, this is a poem. The reason I want to share this with you is because I want to show you how the poem gets emotional, okay? And how you can show emotion in type. One of the advantages that we have is that the typewriter has a lot of little symbols and things, you know? And so we should use them. You see, because you see in my poems, I use italic. You know, I put italic words in my poems. That doesn't help you in a poetry contest because the people reading the contest get mad at you for using more stuff. They want the poem in the raw. Come on, man, there are italics in reality. Okay, so this actually happened. I lived in San Diego for the longest, and this is how it goes, okay? You tell me why it's called suicidal societality. The man from the United States Immigration Office drives an unmarked vehicle, which does not say so, slowly through the streets of sunny San Diego, like a catcher of stray dogs looking for people who are so described by the authorities on said subject matter, to whom such a thing would matter, of these pretentiously un-United States, of human conflict and what is legal and what is fair, and just what is just ice, describe these people's feelings with whose lips they kiss their wives good morning and go off to do the duty they must do as the holy and unlawful so prescribed. So they spend this day chasing and catching grown men in the image of God, whom they say they represent. It was one clear and sunny such San Diego day. My eyes with me behind them had the sad misfortune to witness unto God. It was not a lovely sight. No, not one. One would not have wanted to have seen it for oneself. Their vehicle was stopped at the corner of an indecent street where crimes of daily indiscreet agree to meet to transact life with a sad and mundane fact, waiting for the light to change. Like a patient vehicle of unsuspecting unimportance, except for the lives of its occupants, all living in a slow kind of hurry. When, all of a sudden, the side door flies open and out runs this man at the top of his desperate heart speed, like a kid just doing something, and he has to run to do it. When then two other grown men jump out of the vehicle van and give chase to the man down the street, just like kids having done something and just have to run. When one man dives through the air, oh, this is tense, not at all, not at ease, and he tackles the man running like we love to see in the movies, but this is not, this is real life unfolding in a drama, and he knocks him down to the ground, his face against the ground, like the sole of a very determined shoe instead of man in the sole against the ground. That was a terrible fight. You really don't want to see it, unless, of course, you enjoy such sights, finding them some delight, as a poet might be condemned to do. Two grown men fighting, two grown men with their hands rolled in the fist, throwing their fists against a sea of air, striking angels and demons, the wind, the breath of life, trying desperately to kill each other off, full of hate against each other, for unknown reasons in this world, unknown to them, unknown to you, suddenly a mystery to me. When then the other grown man jumps in, and he's against the man who started it with his running, and very quickly, in the heat of this day, it's all over between them. Together now, the men drag the man away like heavy luggage, and they throw him among the other men, whom they betrayed as men on this God-given day. Well, I find myself with my throat filled with my own blood yelling, let him go, motherfucker!
let him go. And people milling around in their circles in the street below look up to my window. In their eyes, I could see them thinking, I am mad.
So, famous tagmates. Okay, any questions? And we'll do one little assignment, okay? I think we have, yeah, right? Anything, anybody want questions, say, this is it?
So the emotion, you're talking about the emotion, mm-hmm. And so you're using like capital letters to show the emotion of your intense feeling, that you're yelling,
yeah,
and that's the intensity of your feeling?
Yes. So not every time that you use capitals are you yelling. You might use capitals sometimes in the poem. It's not necessarily yelling, but being emphatic about something. But here is more like a guttural cry. And I just play around with it. I try to make it sound on the page. I don't try to make images. You know, they're just accidental or coincidental if they appear. I'll give you a good example. Like in this poem here, I have a performance on Saturday. You're welcome to come. It's in my building. I live in the art space in Manhattan. It's on 99th Street. And I'm going to perform with some poets, and we're going to read some. We have a jazz band. It's like a 50-piece jazz band. And we're going to knock these poems out. So I'm going to read A San Diego Southern African Night, which is a poem I wrote in San Diego about a black man getting a jaywalking ticket at 2:30 in the morning, where the only car that could have possibly run him over was the police car that was stopping him to give him the damn ticket. You know? So, but in that poem, this is the libretto I made for the conductor that's gonna conduct the jazz band while I'm reading the poem. They haven't heard the poem. So, but you can throw this down. And this poem is about 11 pages long. Because it goes through the whole experience of the black man. But this particular page, I don't try to make images, but I'm going to show you how poetry knows what the hell it's doing, not poets. Okay? And this page is funny for me, because this page is the moment the cop is giving him the ticket. And if you look at it closely, it looks like the cop's face and a heart on. And it's really funny. Because here it says, let me start the ticket thing, watch. It says, Now the man cop calls the black boy to come out from out of the car real easy, like slow, and sign here on the line to say that I gave you this and that you took it. And now understand that you owe the good people of this fair city, truly America's finest fair city, $35 of your hard earned, however it is that you get a cold cash, because you did cross the street while the yellow light was blinking, and then did turn red by the time you got to the other side. And so I see his heart on doing that. I mean, like, you know, big dude, yeah, you know, that's a lot. You know, what happened that night, I'm going to tell you, this is how the poem ends. I really encourage you to come to the poetry again. It's on my Facebook page. This is how the poem ends. And this is what made me write the poem. So I'm sitting, I'm on this windowsill, and I'm looking out. And this is going down right here. Right across the street, about 2 o'clock, 2:30 in the morning. I mean, it was so ridiculous, I had to turn around and see what time it was. I said, okay. So this thing took about 40 minutes to give this guy a ticket, because they had to hassle him. They couldn't record. So the poem is a description of the whole goddamn thing. But I had no intention of writing the poem until the ironic moment occurred. Again, here's the ironic poem, the ironic moment. So I'm watching, I see the whole thing, and I say, man, wow, poor guy, I'm fucking cops. I'm doing all of this inside, right? So now the cops give him the ticket. And the poem says, when he actually gives him the ticket. It's, the man cop gives him the ticket with pride, like a piece of art, but it ain't, tearing it from out of the book of them. That's the line. So when the cop did that, he gives him the ticket, the guy goes to continue crossing the street. And of course, the light is against him, but he don't care, the cops don't care, and he's mumbling under his breath. And what he's mumbling is the ironic moment. He is mumbling in a mantra, I know I'm not white, I know I'm not white, I know I'm not white, I know I'm not white. But I said, oh, okay, bro. I sat my ass down and I started to write, and that's how the poem is. And this becomes its own scat. Okay, its own scat in the poem. I don't want to wait, I don't want to wait, all right. And what happens is that it gets so prolonged that after a while it changes what it sounds like. And what it actually sounds like is, I don't know why. That's pretty interesting. So we're going to do that shit on Saturday. Okay? I'm going to throw that down. Anyway, I mean, these books for the conductor so that he can just turn the page like a libretto, you know? Okay. Any other questions? We have we'll give out the candle thing. We could try this. Okay. We're going to, as we give out the candles, here, everybody take a candle. We want them back. Okay?
Index cards?
Oh, index cards. Yeah. Just give two index cards. Yeah. Okay.
Just take two and pass them around.
Thank you very much. Okay. So what we're going to do now.
Take two.
Here's the thing. I'll try to do this real quick. Ladies and gentlemen, when people ever ask you, when people ask you to do free writing assignment, what happens is that people just want to write freely, and there's no structure. But even free writing has structure, okay? There's no such thing as free. Everything costs something, and some things cost more than others. And others are worth far more than what you pay for.
Anyone need a pencil?
Okay. Oh, yeah. I forgot to read you two quotes by Lawrence Ferlinghetti. This is a, this is a little book by Lawrence Ferlinghetti. It's called Poetry as Insurgent Art. And it's full of little quotes that he writes. And these are just my two favorite quotes. He says, if you would be a poet, write living newspapers. Be a reporter from outer space, filing dispatches to some supreme managing editor who believes in full disclosure and has a low tolerance for bullshit. That if you would be a poet. Now, the other one that I like here is, you must decide if bird cries are cries of ecstasy or cries of despair, by which you will know if you are a tragic or a lyric. Those are my favorite quotes for this book, okay? But I believe that. The bird cries, you have to decipher. Well, are the bird cries, you know, pain or joy? Me, I think that birds in the morning are actually praying to start the day. And when they come home in the afternoon, they're talking about what happened. That's what I think. Because they get up before anybody else and they make a whole racket. So why do they do that? I think they're praying. Okay, we're going to do a stream of conscious writing assignment, which I call the talking candle. The talking candle. This started, I use real candles, but this started when I was, I used to borrow my brother's apartment when he wasn't there. I didn't have the key, but I knew how to get in. And what happened was is that one day, they cut my brother's electricity. They cut his electricity. And there was no light in the house. And I went there to crash and to write poetry. So I lit a candle. And as I lit the candle, the one of his windows was broken. Just a piece of it. So the wind was coming in. and the candle was really struggling to keep the flame happening. And that struggle made me realize that the candle had a life of its own. And it was trying to keep its life going. And so I wrote a poem for the candle. It begins, "The candle is having difficulty holding the flame to its lips." I forgot the rest of it, but that's how it begins. And that gave me the idea for the talking candles. So, talking candles, we're gonna, well, these are not real candles, but they flicker. And that's the main thing they need to do, is flicker. Now, you can do this at home. And when you do it at home, yeah. You can do this at home. When you do it at home, you don't need a gigantic candle. But what you do need is the flame. And you put it down in front of you with a pan and pen. And what you do is you allow the flame to talk to you. It's like eavesdropping on prayer. Okay? Because people light candles to supplicate God, right? Or whatever higher belief they have. So you're actually using the candle as a vessel to reach, you know, the entity that you want to reach. And so I go, well, if people are lighting candles all over the place, there's all these prayers going on. So can we eavesdrop on them? Right? So this is like prayer backwards, or eavesdropping on prayer. In a regular candle, in a real candle, there are two flames. There's a little yellow flame, and then there's a flame inside that flame. And that's really where I try to focus, because that guy, he stays still, but he's still swayed by the outer light. And if you do this in earnest, yeah, the candle will communicate with you and let you know some stuff that you should know. That you know, but you should know, don't know, you should know, you know. So I'll let you go. So just do this about 5 minutes, right? Or 3 minutes?
Maybe 3.
Okay, 3 minutes. And then just see what happens. But just devote yourself to that focus for just these 3 minutes. Okay. Thank you. Thank you. Start right. Thank you, guys.